Hello, everyone. My name is Judith Oginga Martins. I work with UN Habitat as an urban planner and researcher, focusing on the new urban agenda and SDG 11 on sustainable cities and communities. I am also affiliated with Blekinge Institute of Technology in Sweden, where we have been focusing on sustainable transport and mobility. Today's lecture is on sustainable electric mobility, with the focus on energy, policy, and innovation. It is divided into several parts, with part one focusing on achieving electric mobility within the context of sustainable, low-carbon mobility. This will look at the sustainability challenges in the transport sector, the global agenda on addressing these challenges, and the strategies towards low-carbon mobility with a focus on walking, cycling, public transport, and low emission vehicles. Many cities around the world face urban sprawl caused by urbanization and an increase in population. The mobility system has not kept pace with growing transport demand. Inadequate transport systems have led to traffic congestion and pollution that harms the economy, health, and the environment. Local governments recognize the urgency to make urban and regional transport more sustainable for the sake of continued economic growth, equity, safety, health, and the environment. What you see on your screen currently is the current sustainability challenge. And this graph here represents a sustainability spectrum whereby we have a state where we are achieving or moving towards a sustainable future and one that is unsustainable. The current prognosis is that we are unfortunately still moving towards a destructive trend, with cities occupying 5% of the landmass yet being responsible for 70% of the emissions. If we are to move towards a sustainable future, we need to look at our fossil fuel vehicle fleet. One of our suggestions that could possibly help us move towards a sustainable future is to move away from fossil fuels, switch to electric mobility powered by renewable energy, and this will lead us closer to a sustainable future. As mentioned in the previous slide, our cities have a high energy use and dense population. This makes them a CO2 hotspot. Some of the sources of CO2, of course, do not come only from the transport sector. We do have the industries as well as the building sector being a major source of CO2, but transport still remains the major source of CO2 and other climate pollutants in our cities. This means that there needs to be urgent intervention in the transport sector for us to be able to address an impending climate challenge as we move into the future. Did you know that a fifth of global black carbon comes from the transport sector? And in the year 2016, about 4.2 million people died of outdoor ambient air pollution. 4.1 billion people in 120 countries have zero or limited access to low sulfur fuel, while 90% of the air pollution related deaths happen in low and middle income countries. 50% of countries are still using high sulfur fuels that are 50 to 1,000 times above international level. 90% of black carbon emissions from the transport sector come from diesel vehicles. In response to some of these challenges, global leaders have come up with a number of frameworks which are helping us move towards sustainable mobility. The main ones highlighted in this presentation are the Sustainable Development Goals, the SDG 11 on Sustainable Cities and Communities, the New Urban Agenda, the Paris Climate Agreement, the Sendai Framework, and the Addis Ababa Action Agenda. Some of the mobility concepts that we are exploring towards the global agenda with the purpose of achieving sustainable cities and communities is sustainable urban mobility through sustainable urban mobility planning, promotion of non-motorized transport and public transport. And here we are talking about walking, cycling, bike sharing, BRT systems and modal integration, And also from a planning perspective, we are talking about compact cities and smart growth, where we reduce the need to travel and increase concentrations of activities over short distances. Some of the policy changes that we need to consider can be divided into four sections. We have planning instruments, users and markets, vehicles and infrastructure, energy and material supply. When it comes to planning and instruments, the current situation is that planning is still largely car-centric and it is encouraging communities to be car-dependent. An intermediate step is to move towards public transport and intermodal transport systems. And an ideal step is, on top of planning for public transport and intermodal transport solutions, we need to plan with other sectors to ensure that we are achieving denser, mixed, smart, and compact cities. When it comes to users and markets, we need to move away again from encouraging users to buy the private vehicle, but instead we want to change the behaviors of the users in the markets to move towards public transport and active mobility, such as walking and cycling. When it comes to vehicle and infrastructure, currently we still have a majority of the global fleet being very fossil fuel dependent. An intermediate step would be to move towards hybrids and biofuel cars. And of course, an ideal situation would be to move towards electric vehicles that are powered by renewable energy. It is important to say at this point that electrification alone is not sufficient to achieve sustainable transport. The source of the energy that is powering electric vehicles is very important. If the source is not sustainable, then the electric car on its own cannot be sustainable. This leads us to the energy and market supply. Currently, the supply chain is still very fossil fuel based, and we are looking to move towards the use of waste and biomass as we look at the circular economy, and then of course look at other non-exhaustible sources of energy, such as sun, wind, water waves, and so on. So what are the alternative travel modes to the private car? If you have, for example, a population of, let's say, 50 people, and you need to transport them from point A to B, what would transporting them look like in our cities? If all the people chose to have their own individual cars, as you see in the image in front of you, then they occupy quite a lot of space. And you find that our street space or our land space gives way to too much space for the automobile, the private car. The same amount of people can be transported more efficiently with less space occupation, either through the use of active mobility such as walking or cycling, or the use of renewable vehicles in the form of a sustainable bus, such as an electric bus or a biofuel bus. UN Environment recommends that we should set aside at least 20% of our total transport budget to fund non-motorized transport programs at both national and city levels. Having mentioned this, what are the elements of low carbon mobility? This includes reducing the amount of traveling or the need of traveling, and this is possible also by implementing remote working possibilities. During the COVID-19 pandemic, we were forced to consider new and innovative ways of working, and it was realized that a number of job groups can actually manage to continue working remotely and do not need to travel to their places of work, and this, of course, reduces the need to travel. Another strategy or element of low carbon mobility is to promote public transport. Public transport has the potential to move larger masses of people, while at the same time, it is efficient and reduces the need to use the private car. We also are looking to promote active traveling, that is walking or cycling when traveling short distances. And this is made especially possible in compact cities, which have short distances of 15 minutes to 20 minutes. Please have a look at the 15-minute city as proposed by the City of Paris as a reference for this lecture. then we also need as planners to focus on people-centered planning, realizing that our cities are made for people and not made for cars. What if you do not have a budget to implement new systems within your transport sector? We can also look at the current existing transport infrastructure and instead increase the efficiency of the existing transport system. There are a variety of options that can be looked at in this case, and this will be tackled later on in the presentation when we look at sustainable urban mobility planning. Finally, we want to look at speeding up the deployment of low emission alternative energy for transport, and of course, move towards zero emission vehicles, and in this case, electric mobility. There are a number of integrated urban electric mobility solutions within the context of the Paris Agreement, the SDGs, and the New Urban Agenda. Projects such as Solutions Plus and the Urban Electric Mobility Initiative came up with some objectives to develop policies, implement business models, and operate electric mobility solutions in developing and emerging economies, with the view that these countries are quickly motorizing, and if urgent action is not taken, then they could easily become major contributors to carbon and climate pollutants looking into the future. The urban electric mobility is a pledge between the supply side, the demand side, and the regulatory side, whereby the industries have agreed to increase the global market share of electric vehicles in cities to at least 30% by 2030. Cities and governments have agreed to push for policies and regulations that will ensure that about 30% of the fleet of light-duty vehicles plying the cities will be electric vehicles. And the demand side, when you look at national governments and banks, have agreed to increase investment to promote electric mobility.